This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
The Revolution with Juan McCartney is sponsored by J.S. Johnson, Commonwealth Bank, Burger King, Ron's Electric Motors, and Marco's Pizza.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. We're going to talk about several things today. You're free to join in. The numbers are 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259, and the text line is 422-4796. Fire at BPLA, Clifton. Not at the new Station A. Someone tell me, is it Station A on fire? What's on fire? Because this would be the second time a planet BPL caught on fire in 3 years. It appears to be a major fire. Hopefully nobody is hurt. That is unfortunate. I don't know that I would use the term surprising to describe it. Anyway, someone let me know if it's Station A or what's happening. Some of my BPL peeps, key me in. Put me in the loop. Like I said, I want to talk to you about a couple of things today. Firstly, I want to say that even though Sean A. Miller did poorly in the race today, the 200-meter final, I applaud her. She's still our champ. And you still did great in terms of representing your nation. Okay? She perhaps tired herself out from doubling in the 200 and the 400. She just ran the 400 heat last night, did pretty well, came in first, and ran a solid time. And she probably just didn't have the juice, didn't recharge enough to do the 200. And that's what the risk is in doubling up with the events so close to each other. So hopefully she rests up, gets her head in gear, doesn't let this loss break her spirits, and go represent and go get you a gold in that 400 meters. All right, you and Stephen Gardner. But you're still our champ, Shawnee. We still love you. You carry our flag literally on your back around the world for us. And we are very, very proud of you. All right? And you see she had her hair like aqua? Yeah. Representing, man. It's good for her. All right. Now, y'all don't tell me the people said the fire at BPL now. Y'all done try run that one on me before. But the people, the union said the fire. Done had the fire report. All right. It says, Shawnee said she felt something in her hamstring. Okay, I didn't see that part. It says she wasn't tired. She said she felt something in her hamstring and slowed down. Well, I mean, and I don't need to be right about this, but could it be that maybe running the races so close together impacted her hamstring? I don't know. Okay. I don't know. The point is, I am still very proud of her, and she's done great, and she's still our golden girl. All right. Says, yeah, when I think she's more concerned to run the 400 and not the 200. Yeah. Well, if her hamstring's bothering her, I hope she feels better in time for the 4. It's always nice to get another gold medal, but hell, you already got a gold medal. You set the fastest time in the world this year. You know, your accomplishments are many. All right? 400 tomorrow morning. All right, 400 is tomorrow morning. Fair enough. I'm going to be tuned in. I'd like to see that. That'd be great. The semifinals tomorrow morning. Yeah, okay. All right, I want to talk to you today, firstly, about my neighbor. You may or may not know her, but her name was Agnes Nairn. Agnes and Harold Nairn moved into Gleniston Gardens subdivision the same year my parents moved into Gleniston Gardens subdivision. I was 2 years old when my parents moved into our house. So for 43 years, she has been my next door neighbor. After my Aunt Sybil, she was my mother's best friend. After she died, she became very close to Mrs. Nairn. Well, she was always very close to Mrs. Nairn, but she became even closer to Mrs. Nairn, right? And my mother, up until the point she was able, for years and years and years, she would, a chain link fence separates our property. She would go to the fence and they would exchange fruits and plants and all this stuff. And they were always there for each other. They would talk for hours right by that fence, yeah? When my mother was getting older and she lived by herself, she had an episode where she left something on the stove and she went to sleep. And then when she woke up, the house was full of smoke. It was my neighbors, Mrs. Nairn, her sons, her daughters, who came and got my mom, right? And called me, all right? Made sure the fire was out. Fire ruined the kitchen, by the way. I had to replace it. But she was always there for my mother. When my mother got very ill, she would, with frequency, call and check on my mother. She didn't go anywhere for at least, 6, 7, 8 months. I'll tell you where she went when she first went. She didn't go anywhere at the house. Her kids were going back and forth, getting stuff for her. And I don't mind talking about this because her son has spoken about it today. I spoke about it yesterday, and it's in today's paper. All right. When COVID-19 hit, she lived with three of her children and some grandchildren. When COVID-19 hit, it was a difficult time for them because all of them who were working, she was retired, worked in the tourism industry. And so my mother would always tell me, as wild as things got with my mom, when my mom was lucid, she would be like, you need to check on Mrs. Nairn, check on Agnes, go check on Agnes, right? And so I did. And I took them vouchers, and I took them food, and I, helped them out with some things, all right? Because I've known them all my life, and I care so much about them. Right? Her kids and me, my brother and I, my sister, like, we all grew up together, right? When my mother died was the first time Mrs. Nairn had went out, all right? Because she desperately wanted to go to my mother's funeral. It's the first time she went out, right? She went to my mother's funeral and she wept. I buried my mother at the beginning of November. Thanksgiving came around and it filled me again with a deep sense of loss and sadness because my mom loved Thanksgiving, right? When she was able, every year, when she was in her prime, she would cook Thanksgiving dinner. When I'm talking dinner, I mean a spread, right? And when she was no longer able to do that for herself, I would go and get her Thanksgiving dinner from somewhere, right? Bush Cook or Checkers, something like this, right? And I was so distraught. Thanksgiving was there, and I always centered around my mother, right? And so I told my wife how I was feeling. And she was like, well, if you can't get dinner for your mom this year, maybe you go get dinner and give it to someone she would have wanted to have it. And so the first person who came to mind was Mrs. Nairn. And so I took her Thanksgiving dinner, and it made me feel better. She loved it, and it made me feel better because it felt like, in a way, it was still connected to my mother, and I was still doing something for my mother because that's what she would have wanted. Again, Mrs. Nairn went back in the house, didn't go anywhere, right? But she desperately missed her church. She was a God-fearing woman, a kind, generous, patient woman who loved the Lord, loved her church, loved people, was just the epitome of Christian servitude and kindness. Really just great, fantastic people. You know, sometimes you live around people and you just tolerate. These were fantastic people, right? I'm very close with one of her sons, Natty, right? He's the one who spoke about her today. You know, he's a fantastic guy. Just great, great people, right? She desperately missed her church, and she was very involved with the youth in her church. And the Church of God had a youth convention June 30th through July 4th. And she wanted to go. And her son was the one who was very reticent about her going anywhere. And he was working again. And when he called to check on her, her daughter was like, well, she went to the convention. And her son was like, well, I don't know about that. I don't know if that's a good idea, you know, because Mrs. Nairn wasn't vaccinated. And he talked to the people at the convention, and they told him that there'd be social distancing. There wasn't. He told them that there'd be proper. They told him that there'd be proper sanitization. As far as I know, there wasn't. Mrs. Nairn got COVID-19 and died in the hospital last week because she went to a church convention. The contact tracing people told her son that it's from the convention. Not that we could get any concrete information out of anyone from the Church of God. We've tried to contact Bishop Moses frequently. No response. We contacted the Minister of Health. He had said he had no comment. And we contacted the Chief Medical Officer. We tried to contact the Chief Medical Officer and could not get her. Not only did Mrs. Nairn die, her brother-in-law, who attended the convention, also died. My neighbor's aunt, who did not attend the convention, but whose daughter attended the convention and caught COVID and brought it back home to her, she died. Three people in one family are dead because they went to a church convention. So my question is this. Why are you having a church convention in the middle of a pandemic? Why is that necessary? And I see they're having another one scheduled, it looks like. I don't know if it's the same Church of God. Why are you having a convention in the middle of a pandemic? We have pictures from the convention. Some people had masks on, some didn't. You know, people catching the Holy Spirit and all this other stuff like that. You have to be more responsible. And here's the thing, and I know what you're going to say. Well, why didn't she get vaccinated? I don't know that that would have saved her life. But she wasn't vaccinated, and that's what it is. But a lot of God-fearing people who go to church are guided by the actions of the pastors and the leaders in the church. And if the church leaders go, well, it's safe, they believe it's safe because a lot of Christians believe that their pastors have a direct link to God. Right? Trust me, it happens. I went to Kingsway Academy, the most, there may be one more so now, the most Christian indoctrinated school on New Providence, for certain at the time I attended. And you had people in Kingsway Academy who believed that the world was going to end, and therefore they should not plan too far ahead in the future because their pastor said so. With no empirical evidence whatsoever. It is negligent and irresponsible, and the church leaders haven't even bothered to call my neighbor's children. It was negligent and irresponsible, and people died because they went to the convention. And you say, oh, Juan, that's harsh. You say, but it is what it is. You had the convention, people who attended it died, and not only did they die, I know of others who attended the convention who died. At least two others. And there are dozens of people who got sick, many of them accounting for the surge in hospitalizations at PMH. People are going to have to take individual responsibility, and also these organizations are going to have to take responsibility. All right? Now, I'm not saying you can't have church, right? What I'm saying is you got to do it in a responsible manner. That's what I'm saying. Go to church, social distance. There had to be 3,000 people at that convention over the course of those 4 days or whatever it was. 5 days, at least. Many of them young people who are going to catch COVID and be asymptomatic and spread it to other people who are vulnerable who are going to die. Even vaccinated people, you can still die if you're vaccinated. And I'm going to talk about this in a minute too. Please, be responsible. My next door neighbor lost 3 members of his family because they attended that convention. And his sister almost died as well. By the way, his mom came home. She was infected. Two of her daughters and all of her daughter's children. And one of the daughters had to be hospitalized. And she has recovered at this point somewhat. But it's negligent, all right, on the Ministry of Health. It's negligent on the church leaders to have had this convention, to know, they know, that people have gotten sick and died who attended that convention, right? And coincidence ain't that high. All right, all the people who died are linked to the convention. Right? I know that for a fact. You gotta take this thing seriously. This woman was a sweetheart. After my mother died, she would sometimes go and stand by the fence just to have the familiar feeling of when she would talk to my mother over the fence. You gotta be responsible, all right? You gotta take COVID seriously. I'm not saying run and duck and hide in your house. That's not what I'm doing, but I'm saying don't be risky with it. You don't need these big events right now. Particularly, yeah, it says the Ministry of Health is negligent as well. Yeah, the Ministry of Health is negligent. Yeah, you haven't informed the public. You keep what information you want to yourself. Because why? You don't want to be seen as going against the church? It is what it is. If it happened at a school, you wouldn't have no problem saying it. If it happened at some large event, you wouldn't have no problem saying you were dead fast to talk about, oh, it's, yeah, holiday weekend is accounting for the uptick in cases. July accounted for the second, the month of July was the second highest number of COVID cases we've reported. And by not too much. The last highest was October of last year. COVID is a real problem, particularly for people who are older and who have comorbidities. Mrs. Nairn was diabetic. Her kidneys failed, her liver failed, her lungs failed. I understand wanting to worship God. I do. But God wants you to be smart about what you are doing. I'll do some text messages. And you can call 323-6232-325-4316, 325-4259. The text line is 422-4796. This says, awesome person, Juan. My family from Andros. Her husband died a month before my dad. Yeah, Mr. Nan died quite some time ago. He died before my father died. It says, Juan, there has to be individual responsibility when people die from going to large public gatherings with no vaccination. Statistics show there's a 95% chance those people who died will be alive if they were vaccinated with a COVID vaccine. Yeah, but she still could have died, right? And the fact that she wasn't vaccinated, and if you, I don't even know what the reason was. Maybe she decided after it was too late and they started running out of vaccine. I don't know. But I know that if you're running a convention and you're a church and you tell people, come and it's safe, we got social distancing, blah, 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 then the members of the church are going to believe you. They believe that it's safe. Why would my pastor tell me something safe when it's not? He only wants what's good for me. Right? So you're going to have to take responsibility for that. We can take a phone call. Let's do it. Let's take the phone call, Ollie. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
McCartney.
Hey, how's it going?
It's a sad situation there. Wing of Time, Google Dr. David Andrews. He's UM, a doctor lawyer. He's a lab sequence. He does a virus sequence. He says this Delta version is so contagious. It's like the chicken pox.
Yeah, I've read that. Yeah.
He says it is so contagious. It's like three times worse than the ones that did before. So we have to tighten up. But what you did yesterday, I was so happy to see rain come yesterday so everybody can stay home. Because the Prime Minister ain't taking this as serious as he should. Yesterday, it would have been one big beach party. But God see it that he sent the rain. And that calmed the people to stay home. This Delta version is not to be played with. The doctor, Dr. Morris, said they are both think on the job.
Yeah.
I heard on 2010, she said Dr. Morris is about to explode. Too many cases. So we are mentally exhausted. Imagine a doctor exhausted treating you. He'll make mistakes, right? Mm-hmm. If you're on the job and you're exhausted, what about our doctors here? The doctors say, like, they are exhausting it too. Like, we have to make a tough decision if we are going to live.
Yep, agreed. Thanks. Says, no disrespect to you, Juan, but if I recall clearly, you were bigging up T.G. Morrison for standing up to the government that they don't have the authority to tell church what to do. The pastor went as far as saying COVID is not in the church. Now look, I'm sorry for your loss. No, you're conflating two different things. I big up T.G. Morrison for standing up to the government. I never said the government doesn't have the authority to tell church what to do. I big up T.G. Morrison because I don't think churches needed to close. I still do not think churches needed to close. A church service and a church convention are two completely different things. Have the church service, do it at the limited capacity, do your social distancing, do your sanitization. But a 5-day convention where you have people in and out and there's no opportunity to sanitize the building between the days, it doesn't make sense. So I still support churches being open, but a church service and a church convention are two different things. I don't know what you're trying to at me for. I'm consistent in my views on this. You can have church. You can have school. Right? Do you have big rallies? No. It says, you do know that India's problem became dire, fueled by unrestrained and unrestricted religious and political gatherings. Yep. It says, good afternoon, Juan. What's really going on with these crowded clubs and hotels? I've been seeing videos. The people who work in the hotel clubs still have to leave the hotel and be among their family and others. Are we really taking this thing seriously? We can talk about that in a minute. It says, well, Juan, the church took their inch and run with it and turned into a mile. Church service gone to convention. Well, ask yourself this. Church conventions are banned. Yes? Social gatherings are banned. Yes? So who gave them permission to have that convention? Church services are permitted, but social gatherings, including church conventions, are not, except if they get permission. So ask yourself, who gave the Church of God permission to have that convention? And then get back to me. This says, so I couldn't go on the beach yesterday because of the rain. Therefore, a minute's got to go. I saw someone said they blame Menace for Shawnee Miller. Performance this morning. Oh, Lord. Juan, please encourage people to drink lots of water, eat ginger and lemon water in the mornings. Please, let's encourage natural remedies. Fair enough. We're going to talk about the arrivals, all that. I can get to that. Don't worry about that. All right, because you remembering what I said about T.G. Morris, you remember what I said about testing the tourists? You remember that? Y'all remember that? And I was the crazy person. I didn't know the science. Remember that? The pandemic over for a vaccinated. Remember that? Remember you send me pictures, articles from the woman from the CDC who also didn't know what she was talking about? Remember? You remember? Remember when they announced that they was going to let in the tourists without testing, that I said that that's risky and a bad idea? You remember? Since we're remembering. All right, we can talk about it. We got to take a break, and we'll be back on the other side.
Of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
It's a hot primo summer, and Marco's Pizza is bringing you the heat all summer long with our fresh dough, three cheeses, and signature sauce. Enjoy our sizzling summer deal that includes one large two-topping pizza, 1 liter Coke product, and a free cheesy bread. Yes, you heard it correctly. It's free, all just for $21. Have a primo summer at one of our Marco's stores today. Every store, every day, the Italian way.
Throughout our lifetime, we must all make decisions. No matter how we choose, the right one just needs to be made. Like having J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers as your insurance partner. We've been serving the Bahamas for over 100 years. Whether you need home, motor, marine, or commercial insurance, make the right decision. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com.
J.S. Johnson.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. All right, we got text messages. One, you're brave. These people are going to die, saying God will protect them. Criticizing the Church of God, yep, you're brave. It ain't no bravery to criticize the Church of God. They did something that didn't make sense, and it is what it is. It says, my mom and your neighbor were friends as well. I knew her my whole life. They would pass things over the fence, too. They were very close. My mom died first, and her friend died a year later on my mom's birthday. Oh, sorry to hear that. And I wonder if those people who attended the convention trusted God to keep them safe. When things like this happen at church, I can't help but think like this. Just would like to know their thoughts. Yeah, me too. I mean, the church people were saying it. They told their son, no, it's safe. We're doing protocols and all this other stuff like that. And clearly they weren't doing what they were supposed to do. And you don't need thousands of people over a several-day convention. You don't, okay? You can have your church service. You don't need a convention at this time. You can have your church service. Go worship God. Go praise God. Do it in a responsible manner. Not everybody all over each other. And have your church service. But not your convention. Hi, Juan. I noticed that people genuinely believe that COVID is dangerous for the majority of people. Would you clarify for me whether COVID is dangerous for most people? For most people, no. Not yet. Now, the variants may develop into something much worse, but for the majority of people who catch COVID will be okay. The majority of people probably will not catch COVID, right? If you're elderly, you have comorbidities, you're overweight, you're going to have a problem. Even if you're in your 20s and 30s, you're going to have a problem. I know a friend of mine in his 30s, morbidly obese, had to go to hospital for COVID. All right. Hey, Juan, was this Church of God in East Street? No, this was Joe Farrington Road. Good afternoon, sir. My condolences to you and your neighbor, but preach about getting healthy and not pushing fear of death into people's minds. Live, you may die. Live, you may, die, you must. Well, that's not a sensible way to approach life at all. I'm not going to do that. Live, you may, but die, you must. Do you approach all aspects of your life in that manner? Do you run into the street, into oncoming traffic, because live, you may, but die, you must, so you just do whatever the hell you want to do? That makes sense to you? You place yourself in harm's way unnecessarily because, hey, We're gonna die sometime. It says, you remember when you said Minnis wasn't gonna win the last general election? No, you got me confused. I don't remember that. No. I thought Minnis was pretty lousy, but I didn't see the PLP winning that election, son. No, sir. Don't put that on me. It says, hi, condolences to the Nairn family. This is how brainwashed some people are when it comes to religion. I don't think she's brainwashed. I think she just felt she would be safe. Good afternoon, Juan. I was at a church on Carmichael last weekend. The church did well with sanitization on the outside. Once you got in, there were no rules other than you can't use your cell phone during the service. Some people had masks on, others didn't. What was so disturbing about this church was that the apostle told his congregation not to listen to the PM. COVID ain't the only thing that can kill you. His rhetoric was unbelievable. I am fully vaccinated, and I wore my mask throughout the service. It says, thank you for that clarification, because I thought it was the Vaccine Center, Church of God, East Street. I got an appointment there. I was just about to cancel. No, not that one. It was at the big one on Joe Farrington. Hi, Juan. Do you think variants can develop in vaccinated people who got infected? Also, are you able to find out if any of those in hospital were naturally immune? They keep saying none in hospital are infected. I don't know if I could try find out if they're naturally immune. But yeah, there's a, you know, the Dr. Gert van de Bosch, who 52 references sometimes, he, and we'll talk about this. And I so hate this thing where if you present any alternate point of view than what the general consensus is out there, that you're some crackpot. But Gert van de Bosch warned against mass vaccination, saying that more dangerous variants could develop. And the man has a Nobel Prize, and they go, oh, he's a quack. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And one day we're going to go through his stuff, because I'm not going to be sitting here and be cowed. But, well, if I don't present the narrative, I'm fear-mongering, or I'm anti-vaccine, or da-da-da-da. Remember, the vaccine was going to end the pandemic. You all know, we forget already. The vaccine was going to end the pandemic. Remember they said that? It says, good day one. Who has more vaccines than India? The vaccinator is spreading the virus and is causing the mutation. Vaccinated persons are behaving as if they are immune and they had abandoned the protocols. All right, so let's talk about it, because we got a couple of minutes here, because I want to talk about how we got here, right? Maybe how we got here, okay? So in April, the Prime Minister announced that he would allow vaccinated people to come to enter the Bahamas without any form of negative COVID test, okay? I didn't understand the rationale at the time, and I said so. Almost every other Caribbean country requires a COVID-19 test of some sort to enter, and they're still doing great business. Turks does. They're doing great business. B, the Americans who come here can get tested for free in America. It's going to be a wait now since COVID surge, but the Americans can get tested for free in America. So what was the issue? What was the hindrance that you thought you were alleviating by allowing them in unvaccinated? All right. C, the Americans have to get a test in the Bahamas, which they have to pay for, which I still don't understand why we're charged for. They have to pay for the test in the Bahamas in order to get back into America. Every person over 2 years old has to get a negative COVID test or documented proof that they've recovered from COVID within the last 3 months, because the CDC doesn't recommend testing within 3 months of having recovered from COVID. I'm not sure if I understand why. All of them have to get a test to get back into America. So you're not doing anything strange. They know the drill. They want to leave America and come back. They need a test. You should have tested out of an abundance of caution. You should have still made them bring a test just to be sure that it's not them. But now you're not, because at the time, without any sort of scientific evidence, there was this narrative being circulated that people with the vaccine ain't gonna transmit, ain't gonna get infected, ain't gonna transmit it. All right? That's the narrative. It reduces your risk of infection, but we now know it does not reduce your ability to transmit it. You parroted the narrative. If you're vaccinated, party on. As if it would all just go away. You gave the sense that things were fine. If you're vaccinated, that's it. Renwood Wells said it was essentially a cure. And this popular narrative was backed by no science. So don't come to me today and talk about the science has changed, because you didn't have any science to begin with. Now you have science, and you know that what you did was dangerous, and you're reversing course. But don't come to me and say the science has changed, because there was no science to begin with to say that that wasn't the case. the CDC, they're up and down. Vaccinated people don't got to wear masks indoors. Oh, but now you do. So I'm very pleased that you are now requiring the tourists to have a test. And I don't think it's going to hurt tourism. I think there's going to maybe be some natural fall off because the pent-up demand is going to ease. And then September, usually it's a slower season and XYZ and the group business isn't quite there, isn't there yet. That would have supplemented that. But it really didn't make sense. It was a reckless move, and I don't know what you were thinking. You've shown me no contact tracing to show that the tourists brought anything here and spread it to Bahamians, the majority of whom are not vaccinated. So I can't say that it's the case, but something must have changed for you to have reversed course. All right? Something must have changed. Now, don't get mad at Menace because he say you need a test to come back to your own country. It is what it is. If you're vaccinated, get the rapid antigen. Children could get the rapid antigen. Although that's, good luck setting a two-year-old down for that. They can do it in the throat, too, they say. Don't get mad with Minnis. If you got to pay for a test to come back to your country, you could get one free in the States, but you probably have to pay for one if you want one fast. Because you was more than happy to pay for a test to go to the States in the first place. Says Juan, I'm not knocking Christianity and by no means all Christian leaders, but I wouldn't be surprised if the decision to have this conversation may have been strongly driven by the prospect of offering collections. I don't know. Says Juan, in all fairness, when vaccinations had first begun, I'd message you to show your show to say that the vaccinated could still spread COVID. Your response was completely dismissive, and you say the data in Israel shows since vaccination transmissibility rate was significantly less, and that you were believed the vaccinated persons do not spread COVID. No. Y'all on some water today. I didn't say that. Not never. You, in fact, you need to pull the audio for me to even begin to believe I said that. That is not true. I stated, and I went through meticulous data from AstraZeneca, from Pfizer, to show that they do reduce the risk of transmission, but you can still spread the disease. Don't say I said things I didn't say. Please. It ain't gonna work. All right? I try to remain consistent in my positions. I never had no data to say that you can't spread COVID-19. I've always maintained that you still can. And in fact, I've said that from May. Not from May, from March. And when the Prime Minister made this announcement in May, I said, you don't know that these people can't bring COVID here. You're totally misstating what I said. That's not true. It says, one, just have virtual services. Say, I say the vaccine, when did I ever say you can't spread the virus with the vaccine? Y'all be hearing a different show. It ain't this one. It says, Juan, I wonder if delegates came in from the Family Islands for that convention. How could you say I said that when I'm the one who, when the CDC lady was talking about it's the pandemic of unvaccinated and Minister was saying it's two pandemics, I said it didn't make any sense because you could still transmit the virus. I've known that the whole time, the entire time. Why would I say that when I said that it's dangerous to allow the tourists to come in because you don't know if they're spreading the disease? I didn't say that. That bothers me when people do that to me. Don't do that. Many of these church leaders and their flocks behave as though they're a law unto themselves. Jesus told Peter he must obey the laws of the land. When Peter thought because he was a Christian and was the chief right-hand man that they should not even have to pay taxes and abide by the laws of the Roman government, I heard two pastors defy the PM's pandemic ruling. If I was Minnis, I would have put the police in place to enforce any breaches by those pastors and their flocks. I still don't understand why there's a one-hour limit on the church service. I don't get it. I don't get it. Okay? I'm not saying don't have church. I'm saying don't have the convention. I don't get it. I went to the movies over the weekend. Saw Boss Baby, which is actually quite good. And, you know, people were socially distant. Well, I socially distanced myself from myself and my family from people. All right. And it was fine. And we were in there for 2 hours. So I can do that. But yet the church, it's 1 hour. Why? I don't get it. It says, Juan, there's no way Kingsway was more religious than NCA. 95% of our teachers were American missionaries. I'm telling you, so were ours. So were ours. They were great people. Almost to a T. They were missionary teachers or had been missionaries. I'm telling you. Right? And then there were, we had a few Jamaican teachers. We had some Bahamian staff as well. But every single one of them was a Christian. All right? Now we got to take a break. Okay. Let's go to the break and we'll be back. Why would I be saying I said things I didn't say? Like, when did I ever say, you can't, you've been here this whole time. When did I ever say that vaccinated people can't spread COVID? We had no idea. I've read the data about reduced infection. So I say, because there's reduced transmissibility and infection, because I say there's reduced transmissibility, I'm saying people can't spread the virus. That doesn't make any sense. All right, let's go to the news break. All right, we'll be back.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the revolution here on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Now, we have some more vaccine came. You can now go again and register to get vaccinated at vax.gov.bs. And the United States government has donated several ultra low temperature freezers so we can get some Pfizer. It's very nice of them. Such good friends. All right. Now, people are going to get mad at me, right? I know, but I gotta say, or let me do it this way. Explain, Eric Carey said there's going to follow up on the government's investigation into a wood infested, into wood infested with a tree-destroying beetle that was offloaded on Grand Bahama last month. Carey said the trust would hold off on saying more until more facts arise from the government's investigation. The government, through the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources, the Department of Environmental Health Services, the Department of Public Prosecutions, and the Department of Forestry, released a joint statement Friday on the matter. According to the statement, the government intends to pursue this matter to the fullest extent of the law after acknowledging that the wood was offloaded from a vessel called the Pan Jasmine onto Grand Bahama without prior knowledge, consent, or approval of the relevant government agencies, including Bahamas Customs, the Department of Environmental Health Services, Marine Agriculture, Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources. Now I gotta do this. I want someone to help me. This says, where's the jump? Okay, this says the Customs Department was made aware of the wood on July 24th. Based on information received, an investigation has been launched. Concerning the offloading of suspected unidentified insect-infested dunnage or rough wood used for packaging that was offloaded at a location near the Freeport Harbor and transported to the Pine Ridge landfill. The statement explained that the wood and containers used to transport it were treated to destroy the beetle, adding that a private company was hired to fumigate the bins in surrounding areas as well as the barge that was used to transport the wood. Now, I'm not saying that's cool, right? That somebody offloaded the wood or whatever. Because I understand it was from Mexico, and they tried. Mexico wouldn't let them do it. And they wanted to go to New Orleans, and New Orleans wouldn't let them do it. And then they came to us, and somebody let them do it. And so that shouldn't happen, right? But two questions. If New Orleans said no, right, can't you just dump the wood in the sea? Wouldn't that solve the problem? Or we can't do that. You gotta dump the container too? Or what is it? I don't see why you can't dump the wood in the sea. I know why you gotta bring it here. That's the first thing. The second thing is, where is the uproar about? How dangerous is this thing? Someone help me to understand. Like, it eats all trees? What does it do? That it's so dangerous that you can't have it at all. Not that we want some invasive species, but I'm just saying. Like, why does it require the Bahamas National Trust, the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources, the Department of Environmental Health and Services, the Department of Environmental Health Services, the Department of Public Prosecutions, and the Department of Forestry, and the Customs Department to conduct an investigation into this? Seems like a lot. Maybe this thing is the end of all times. I don't know. Maybe they're like zombies. It says the wood floats, Juan. Well, that's true. The wood does float. Yeah. You got a point in my drift. I guess you could chain it up. I guess you can't dump the container. Yeah, that makes sense. If the wood wouldn't sink, you weight it down, eh? No? All right. So much for that plan, I guess. Someone sent me, said the ship was, if the wood had been offloaded into the U.S., it would have been put in a Louisiana landfill where the insects could crawl out and invade the local habitat, causing incalculable damage. Someone tell me how dangerous these things are. Let me know. All right? So, I don't know what they do. Joe Darville is really upset about it, so, but he gets upset easily. Sound like you'd be doing plenty littering. No, I'm not littering. I'm just saying. Royal, who do people is? Is it MSC? Who dumped in our waters? The black water. If you could dump it, if you could dump that, I don't know why you can't dump the wood, but if the wood can float, then yeah.
I don't get it. All right, let's go to the phone lines. 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. By the way, I won't be here next week or the week after that, barring some major national development. So I'm working now on your guest host for you. So I can't say yet because I haven't firmed it all up. But I won't be here, just FYI. All right? I don't want to know how it's going either, so just enjoy the guest host. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan McCartney, Sheldon Johnson.
Hey, how's it going?
Ask your questions. You can't dump the wood within 12 miles of any country. That's their territorial waters.
Okay.
Up to 20 miles, actually, the economic zone. International waters is also illegal to dump. So essentially, the proper place to dispose of it of land is to a land. The ship originally came out of Mexico. It was carrying some aluminum. And so when they discovered, apparently, when they came into the U.S., they inspected the ship as it was entering. And when they came in, they noticed that this wood was on the ship, and they didn't have an explanation as to why they weren't offloaded in Mexico. The inspectors checked, and they saw some boring fills. You know, like when they dig in, they checked the wood, and they found five different insects in the wood. Mm-hmm. One of them is a longhorn beetle. It's called Cerebumcidae or something of that sort, and an ant member. And an ant is also a member, close member of the Marasenae or something like that family. Yes, the danger is. On the longhorn beetle, they bore into trees, mostly new birds trees. Mm-hmm. And they live on the leaves and twigs and young bark. Okay. Then as the eggs are born, they dig further into the bark, and then the larvae bore into the middle of the tree. I think it's called a cambium, and it's the cambium is the part that feeds the send the juices up to the trees and the fruits and whatever. So in essence, the tree dies. They are prolific in their hatching. 90 times 90 times 90 times 90. And so they could actually destroy complete environment, crops, trees, etc. More so for Grand Bahama, for the fact that we just came with a Hurricane Dorian, and we have a lot of new growths or whatever. The United States has spent hundreds of millions of dollars trying to address the introduction of these species into their country. And so it's just, I don't know, besides the two ants, what the other three insects were involved in it. Now, when you talk about a thorough investigation, should have to go in, because we consider ourselves a maritime country, and if you actually have alerts and shipping alerts and et cetera that goes on, they should be notified. You know, that's an assumption that we use technology, but you have a shipping manifest that goes on, alerts, denials, everything that has happened within it. The problem is that the Bahamas has become known as an international community as a dumping ground for places like Mexico, the U.S., and any place else that any cargo that you won't take it to the Bahamas.
Yeah, remember they said the ship that was on fire?
Yes, and they still have not done. In fact, one, just let me, as a side note.
Did they all investigate that, or did they?
No, they said it was investigating it, but let's use an example. The former deceased Kendall KCX Colebrook and myself protested that.
I heard KCX died, man.
Yes, yeah.
What happened? I know he was
he was
diabetic, right?
Yes, no, he's suffering from cancer.
Cancer,
yes,
yeah.
Right, but they said he died from a cardiac arrest at the hospital.
Oh, Lord, that's so sad.
Yeah. And so, but we protested that ship, but believe it or not, right, we protested the yard where those three individuals just recently died. Mm-hmm. Because when we went for that ship, they had about a dozen people who was working there with no gloves, no masks, no nothing, not knowing what chemical was on the ship. So we did a live broadcast and everything, protesting that they should be given protection. And it's almost like here it is a few years later, the same location where we protested the need for OSHA standard. The individuals die from not having the protection. But just going back on the bug, just let me tell you the problem is, do you know we had another shipment coming from the U.S. of some wasps, some killer wasps that was also sent here to Freeport?
Killer wasps?
Yeah.
Why are they shipping
because
killer wasps?
They were denied entry into the United States also.
Then why bring it here? Why would killer wasps? That sounds more dangerous than the beetle.
You have individuals who brag and tell you, oh, because you don't know, you all just became aware of this. And this is the argument that on Grand Bahama, is the fact that we are a dumping ground. Believe it or not, right, we believe that the ships drop to the Bahamas because they love us. No, they get to offload their garbage in New Providence and Grand Bahama before they go to the U.S. because they would have to meet environmental standards for those garbage. So, yes, we get a couple of jobs and somebody makes millions of dollars. But we came to be concerned about the environment, impacted by it, all these other different things. But then we're designated in the shipping industry as, don't worry, if it doesn't work, just on the way back out, just dump it off in the Bahamas. Your fill, your ballast, whatever it is, you know, they have no standard. And so until we begin to recognize the value, the multi-billion, if not trillion-dollar value of our oceans and blue economy, because we don't use it, we don't think it has any value, and we will continue to be the dumping ground for ships, for insects, for wood, for garbage, whatever it is. If a shipment can't be accepted in the U.S. and you can't take too much trouble to take it back, just dump it off in the Bahamas.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Right. Thank you.
Everybody. Someone's asking if I remember the lionfish. Yeah, lionfish. Someone had to bring it here, right? Didn't just swim here, did it? I'll never forgive the person who brought the cane toads here, bro. As long as I live, those things are creep me out. Yeah, we'll take a phone call. It's fine. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan. I agree with the Alan comment. The only thing, like I said, I find everything to be troubling. And I said, when the news break, I said, this must not be the first time that something of that nature happened. And as the reason why, when we have these storms or when we have hurricanes, we need not wonder why Grand Bahama always be devastated and most affected. Grand Bahama and, by extension, Abaco, which is very close in proximity. But these are the main reason, is that our authorities, past and present, never stood up for the Bahamas. The Bahamas is always used as a dumping ground. It would happen in no other country. No other Caribbean country would allow such a thing to happen. It just...
But they say they didn't know. They say the authorities say they didn't know.
Yeah, they always say that at the end of the day, and nothing is done about it. Okay, you didn't know, you know now, so how is this matter going to be properly adjudicated and addressed by the appropriate authorities? What course of action is going to be taken? Are these places going to be held liable for what happened in an international court of justice? You know, things of this nature. This is why, you know, sometimes it makes me sick to just think about how we see the Bahamas. And sometimes I could understand why 52 get upset. But then, you know, I for the most part, I try to control my emotion. But things like this really, really disturb me as a vehement, because we don't have any standard. We just passed some environmental law just recently. And how effective is those? Because it's never been tested. Lack of enforcement in the Bahamas has caused us to be in this place. And having to deal with this pandemic is just absurd, that we now could allow someone to bring something to add to what we already going through now. It's just outright ridiculous.
Yeah, I mean, it's a problem that it happened. I just wasn't aware of how dangerous the thing is. That's all. I don't think it needed to come here. But I asked you to explain it to me, and Seattle did a pretty good job. Now, I got a problem with killer wasps. That's going to be a problem. That should not happen. This says, announcing you will not be here has just disrupted my day. I really look forward to 2:15 every day. However, since you must be gone, may humbly ask you to leave the show in very capable hands of Levon and Anku. I cannot tolerate anyone else, please, and thank you. I'll see what I can do. Yeah, I gotta go. I'm gonna protect my mental health. Everybody's saying that now? That's what I'm doing too then. Protecting my mental health. Good afternoon, welcome to the revolution. Nope. Okay. Good afternoon. Welcome.
Hello.
Yes. Good afternoon.
Hey. Good afternoon, Juan. What's up, bro?
Hey. What's happening, my brother?
But hey, out of those two other countries, I think you were saying New Orleans and Mexico.
Yeah.
You mean to tell me someone here didn't even know that what that boat contained or what was in the, what was inside the container.
Yeah, that's strange to me.
I mean, and because
what else are you bringing in?
Let me ask you a question. You remember? I think it was about 2 or 3 years ago when they had a cruise ship would dump poo.
Yeah, Blackwater.
Right? In the water.
And we got fined $40 million.
Like
we didn't get a dime.
Jeez. Anyway, Juan, I give up. You keep their feet to the fire. I give up, bro. You have a good day, son.
All right, buddy. Don't give up. Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution. Hey, buddy.
Hey, good afternoon. Listen, one of the reasons you cannot dump wood in the ocean is because wood floats.
Yeah, that's what they're saying.
Yeah, and if people are in the wood...
All the wood? No, I've seen, like, sunken wood before.
Yeah. Well, no, wood do float. It doesn't matter what type of wood it is.
I've seen wood on the bottom of the ocean.
Well, that would probably wood that has been pumped with. You have a solution that is called pressure treated.
But what about the shipwreck stuff? Shipwrecks?
Yeah.
No? Anyway.
Yeah, shipwreck.
All right, I got you. Yeah. Wood floats. We can agree with that. Yeah.
But listen, Juan, how many investigations this government has promised us in the last 4 years that we have yet to see
right.
any?
Right.
I mean, what is that? Is that their way of getting around the foolishness that they're allowing to happen under their government to say that there's going to be an investigation?
Nobody has any confidence that we're going to find out what happened.
Yeah, I mean, come on. That's ridiculous, man. They need to get rid of the program, man.
Right.
Thank you.
All right. If I want to know the results of an investigation, I can look to... What them fellas' name? They's investigate. The accident in air. The AAIA. Delvin Major them. Yeah, you'll find out from them eventually. But this ain't got nothing to do with them. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hey, Warren.
Hey, how's it going?
Good day. See, they talk about investigation. It's very easy to start off. Any vessel, depending on the size of the vessel that enters your harbor or proposed to enter your harbor, have to call harbor patrol or borders of the port authority.
Right.
They have to declare and they have to get clearance from port authority or harbor patrol in order to enter the harbor. So if they say there ain't nobody, well, they lie. What they could do is start firing everybody in harbor patrol and the port authority because they knew no vessel could enter the harbor without clearance from port authority.
And you have to declare what you have on the vessel, right?
You have to declare how much souls on board, your last port of call, and what your cargo is.
Mm. So they had to know.
And then harbor patrol would send you permission granted.
So harbor patrol would be the gatekeeper?
Yes. I'm a A-master's captain.
Oh, okay. Excellent.
And once you leave in the jurisdiction, you have to let them know you go in. And when you're coming back, you got to let them know this permission to enter the harbor.
I wonder why they let them bring it here. Like, what was that about?
You know what the one word is for that one?
What?
Corruption.
Okay. Okay.
Thanks for thinking, Michael.
Okay. I'm concerned that it says all ships have a manifest. Right. You got to have a manifest, right? And you have to digitally submit the manifest, right? So they knew. It says, I'm a BNT member, Juan, but I really wish the BNT would be harder on these issues and have more regular input, not just reactions. They only seem to give their opinions on issues that already happened. When a shark is killed, when the cruise ship tore up the coral reef, when the Beatles chillax on Grand Bahama, catching a suntan for days. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Hi, Juan.
Hey, how's it going?
Yeah, this is Neville Wisdom. I was just calling. You started your show about Sean A. Miller, and I just was calling to give words of encouragement to her and the Miller family.
Yeah.
And to say basically that from my observation and my information, Sean A. is unfortunate to have had an injury. That can happen to anyone.
Yeah.
And my understanding is that people are feverishly, the best medical technicians available up there are feverishly trying to see how she can be rehabilitated to give a good performance in the 400 meters. And in the event that she's unable to go, we as a country have got to understand that she has been through any number of campaigns for the Bahamas successfully.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
And this time, you know, she has a medical challenge, and that happened. She ran 20.15, jogging the last 40 meters in the heat. So that tells you the kind of potential she had. And it was clear to me when I observed the race this morning that she was laboring. I saw how the way she was able, when she came out of the blocks, mm-hmm. and when she tried to put pressure on her body, she could not respond. And that normally signals either a groin or a hamstring injury. And I have confirmed I know she had had a little nick. I didn't know how severe it was previously, but it has obviously recurred, and we just wish her the best.
Yeah.
You know, and I want the country to pray for her, because she has 24 hours to try to rehabilitate, to try to get ready, and if in the event it's a no-go,
that's fine.
My advice to her would be to shut down, but do not injure yourself.
No.
In a case like this, and she's, you know, be proud of her.
We'll still be proud of her. Do you think that running the 200 had anything to do with it?
No. You know, and I've been telling people that Marie Parekh did the 2-4 combination. In fact, as we speak, there's a girl named Nassan who is doing 3 events: 1500, 5000, and 10000 in one Olympics. It Shawnee got through the most difficult part of her campaign when she won her first heat in the 400 meters. After that, it was kind of clear sailing, because what it meant that over a 3-day period, she would have had to run 6 races.
Mm-hmm.
And when you think about it, in training, I've had athletes run 400 meters in one session. So it's a matter of management. She has an excellent management team with her, and it's just unfortunate.
Yeah.
Injuries happen, and it just happened, and after all these years, this is the first time it may or would have happened to Arshane, and we just wish her the best, man.
Yes,
absolutely. And I know she's going to be okay.
Yeah, she'll be fine. She's champ. She's our champion. We love her. This says, Juan, Freeport is an international port with very low environmental standards compared to its neighbors. The U.S. and Canada sell a lot of material that's harmful to the environment. It's disposed of in Freeport. It's big business. What would be curious is to ask the government to produce a list of hazardous materials that have been disposed of in Freeport for the last 5 years. It says, hi, I run track. Miller and her coaches are making a mistake. This can cause her not to get any medal. She is overworking. It's possible. You know, it was possible. And it says, hi, Juan, it's all an environmentalist stunt. They also start talking about the poisonous frogs again. It's all politics. I don't keep the cane toad on the west side, okay? I ain't ready for that type action, because they say you can't shoot them. If you shoot them, the toxins can spray. So I can't do it. It's not going to work. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Yeah, Juan.
Hi.
How you doing, man?
I'm fine.
Well, see, my thing is, if Shawnee, and I know most experts and Olympians would have said not to run the 200.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if she was in excellent shape, no injuries at all, maybe that's a gamble. But if you had a nick, based on the gentleman, sound like a former coach, who may have indicated that she may have a little issue,
very minor issue, sports, yeah.
Then I would have not allowed her to run the 200 and save herself for the 400, which she would may have been able to defend her crown as being the golden girl in that area. But anytime you have a slight injury, I don't care what you do, you're going to aggravate that more by doing some other stuff. And that's common sense. I don't care who... You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I mean, so, to me, it seems like that makes sense. But
I mean, that's common sense. If I know I'm a gold medalist and I could mash up the 400, I have a little kink, I may still win that. But when I'm going to go out and use up my energy and aggravate that little so-called kink, then you may have a problem. It becomes a major kink. And guess what? Now your 400 is up for grabs.
Yeah.
See, that's what I'm trying to understand. We got to be realistic. She has done well for the Bahamas, but let's be real, man. That's why the management part comes into it, and I listened to all the analysts in the Caribbean and in the United States and in Britain, and they said if they had to make a decision on her, they would have considered her running just the four. And now look what has happened.
Yeah. She still might pull out of it.
Yep.
You know? She still might pull it off.
No, you can't pull out now.
She could pull it off. I'm saying she still might pull out of the injury.
Now, if she didn't have any this little issue she may have had prior to, mm-hmm. maybe. But if you know you had a little issue, you know it's going to be aggravated if you go into something else.
Yeah, I heard the analyst saying that
for the last one.
Yeah, I heard the analyst saying that it's a gamble to double.
Yeah,
like
man,
that.
That's a serious gamble, man. Yeah. I am not going to give up my crown to try to get something else, and I know I'm gonna mash up that 400. I'm gonna stick to that.
Right.
You know, and unless they don't down the Olympics, they will spread out the events down. Now, if they do that, and they say okay, the 200 will be like a couple of days after, then okay, you have a real good chance. But no, man.
Yeah,
I think it was a bad decision.
Yeah, because you saw the Jamaicans, they ran the one and the two. Yeah.
And I'm very, very upset with her management team. Whoever decided that, they were wrong. Dead wrong.
Okay.
I appreciate that.
Yes. It says, hi, Pauline Davis can give us insight into what Miller's doing. She ran the 400 and 200, and she was successful when she focused only on the 200. Pauline Davis, she ain't in Tokyo, eh? No. She in Tokyo? She in Jamaica, where they broadcasting, right? In Jamaicans, Roland's on. But you see they got, like, beef, right? Like, you see when homegirl... they come 1-2-3, right? At homegirl, Elaine Thompson, she was by herself, just happy in the two of them out of two, Shelly Ann Fraser-Pryce, another lady. They was hugging, you see? And then Shelly Ann gave her one of them little, you know, tap. Good job. Good job. She just won a gold medal from your country. That's all you got. I don't know what the vibe is. Sharika Jackson. That's the other one. Yeah. And Sharika Jackson runs the 400 as well. Right. So she'll be running against Shawnee. So will Allison Felix. That's a tough competition. Hard to pull off if you're feeling a little, you know, if you're feeling something. Allison Felix don't run the 400? Well, am I missing something? You're saying no? Or are you just saying she won't be running against her tomorrow? Oh, Sharika's not running the 4. I thought she's a 400-meter runner, right? That's what the analysts were saying. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Yeah, pleasure. Good afternoon to you, Brother Warren.
Hey, how's it going? Well. Good, yeah.
Just, you know, to that previous caller who called, I think it was Shawnee's decision early on not to contest the 400. That is what has been said, that she wanted, saying that she already had a medal. And she was undefeated all in 2019. And that is what people keep forgetting. It was Shawnee's decision at the last minute. I think it was decided that she would then...
Run both
events. So it was her decision to run the 200. And so... You know, they keep saying what the coaches should do. Shawnee had practice, and she was doing well. Just that she came up short.
Well, I figured something must be wrong. I thought maybe she tired herself out because she ran the 400 the day before. But when she ran 24, I was like, no, that's not her.
Just that she, her qualifying time.
She's saying hamstring.
In the heat was not sufficient. She didn't really go out as much to put her in a good lane. You know, that lane 9 was just a difficult lane to run, so she had to exert much more energy trying to get around that curve. And you know, she, Shelton said, she felt her hamstring pulling, so not wanting to injure it further, she decided to freeze up. So let's move on. Let's go for the 400, and let's hope that she does well.
I got it. Thank you. All right, let's go to break, Kermit. We'll come back. I'll deal with your text messages. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Summer is heating up, and Burger King Nassau is bringing the flavor. Introducing our all-new take on a classic chicken sandwich, the Barbecue Swiss Crispy King. Our new sandwich is full of smoky and tangy flavor and features our crispy chicken patty with tangy chipotle sauce, onion rings, bacon, Swiss cheese, lettuce, and tomato, plus a smoky barbecue sauce on a soft potato bun. The new Barbecue Swiss Crispy King chicken sandwich with fries and a Pepsi is a summer treat you will love to eat, but only available for a limited time, and only at Burger King Nassau, where taste is king.
At Ron's Electric Motors, they repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, heat and cooling water pumps, generators and generators back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
Girl, Junior just showed me Bulla Boy in his phone.
What you mean? He take picture of that good for nothing boy?
Shh, you don't want Bulla hair. You say that. You know she always say that's my good child.
So what he doing in Junior phone?
Oh, he there because the police looking for him. He on that wanted list.
Wanted persons in your phone now?
Yes, child. And when police want to find anybody quick, after something happened, they can send picture direct to your phone. Go to Google Play or App Store and search for Crack Crime Bahamas, then pick install and it will go straight to your phone.
There is also a section on missing persons.
Yes, girl. Everybody needs to get this app so police can tell us right away when these people go missing. Just like an alert system.
Yes, it has numbers for Crime Stoppers Bahamas so you can call and nobody knows it's you. Call directly to Miami and give the information without giving your name or anything about you. I tried the other day and when I hear Junior and his boys talking about where they hide those guns, I walk quick around the corner and call that number.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
Throughout our lifetime, we must all make decisions. No matter how we choose, the right one just needs to be made. Like having J.S. Johnson Insurance Agents and Brokers as your insurance partner. We've been serving the Bahamas for over 100 years. Whether you need home, motor, marine, or commercial insurance, make the right decision. Call 397-2100 or visit jsjohnson.com.
It's a hot primo summer, and Marco's Pizza is bringing you the heat all summer long with our fresh dough, three cheeses, and signature sauce. Enjoy our sizzling summer deal that includes one large two-topping pizza, 1 liter Coke product, and a free cheesy bread. Yes, you heard it correctly. It's free, all just for $21. Have a primo summer at one of our Marco's stores today. Every store, every day, the Italian way.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. Good to have you with us. We are not going to be able to take any more calls because I got a ton of text messages. This is Juan. What's that food you're eating? Curry chicken. They can see the food. I can see it on the camera. I ain't shame. You got to eat. I was eating, though. Oh, they see the plate. They don't see me eating. Oh, good. I don't know what to tell you. I got to eat. What's this? You don't like Checkers, Carl? You tripping. I will fight you. Those are fighting words. Their food is delicious. They give me, like, the white meat pieces, you know. I don't eat all. They give me a lot of rice. I only eat, like, about a cup of the rice and then get some mixed veg. I feel like I haven't earned it because I didn't complete my workout today for reasons that are immaterial to this discussion. One, that ship that had the Asian Beatles is a perfect illustration of the cultural state of slackness and corruption in our country. Hi, Juan. Leviticus 13 and 14 gave clear rules to the Jews to keep them from catching leprosy. God didn't say, live your life and I'll protect you. Don't know why some of these church people think COVID is any different. It says, COVID is surging everywhere. All our guests should be vaccinated. COVID will be with us for a while. These anti-vaxxers are the biggest problem. It says, hey, I'm saying live the way you wish, but one day we will all die. That's what I mean when I was saying, oh, when you say live, you may die, you must. Oh, no, man. A little chancy to me. So don't wear your seatbelt, this kind of action, like just in speed. It says, one, I don't believe people are able to separate the fear of COVID from the dangers of COVID. That may be true. McCartney, until we get away from PCR tests, we'll never know what the true percentage of who really has COVID. Researchers have proven that numbers will remain inflated because the RT-PCR also shows positive if you have the regular flu. No, no, we went through this. It doesn't do that. It's not. That's not what it's saying. It doesn't do that. It says, can we speak to the fact that the CDC is essentially removing its emergency accreditation from the RT-PCR tests, telling labs to find alternative sources? Why are we still insisting on it for international travel is no longer the gold standard? They got better tests now. Hey, Juan, are you guys realistically evaluating the restrictions? Do you sing constantly in the movies? Do you jump up and hug people in the movies? Is there a choir in the movies? Then why compare the movies to church? Well, don't be hugging up in the church. I've been in the gym. Okay. Text. This says, why did the Prime Minister say that vaccinated persons were out of the pandemic? Such a careless remark for the leader of a nation. It was reckless. Gym is be sketchy. They wear masks in the gym. Like if you're on the machine, you're not wearing the mask, but if you I gotta go to the gym. I can't, you know. It says, Juan, my friend, I listen to your show every day. You were very explanatory on your show. You said the vaccine will not stop you from catching or spreading it, but the chances are less. For the unvaccinated people, we'll get it more easily. Keep up the good work, bro. Keep safe. Exactly. Telling me I say, how? Juan, those fish in the sea would love those beetles and worms, and it would help the sea become a barrier. Reef, let's be creative. Mm-hmm. Can the beetles swim? Is that a stupid question? I don't know. I'm no beetle expert. As good day, one, I can assure you that the Ministry of Health COVID numbers are incorrect. I live in one of the family islands. People who travel by air and sea to the family islands are required by law to take the 5-day antigen test upon arrival. Most persons do not take the test. The mailboat and airplane each have a manifest. So why a copy of the manifest isn't given to the Ministry of Health on the family island so that persons on the manifest could be contacted to take the 5-day test or be fined if they refuse? Very simple process. But I forgot that some in the public sector are only interested in a salary, not a job. Yep, you make good points. So there's a small nation being dumped on. Yeah, well, it's unfortunate. So it sounds like those insects were engineered in the lab or something. Yeah, it sounds, see, Alan kind of freaked me out. Although the wasps I have a bigger challenge with. It says, the point is customs didn't do their job with inspections and the Bahamas continue to take the world's garbage. It says, hi, it's dangerous because no one else wanted it. Oh, I promised I'd read this text. This is I don't know what I lost it. I lost the text. Sorry. Oh. This says, good afternoon, condolences to the Nairn family from the Major family, especially Dwayne Nairn. All right. It says, hi, Juan. Can you please advise that the vaccines that came in today was AstraZeneca or another brand? Thanks. I didn't hear that info during the presentation. Yeah, it's the AstraZeneca. As far as I'm aware, that those were the ones we pre-ordered, and this is another tranche. Says, let Levin Miller sit in for you for a portion of the time you are off. Enjoy your vacation, sir. Maybe. I'll see if he's interested, but thank you. Hi, Juan, are you going to Hawaii for vacation? I wish. I probably staying right here in this country. I don't want to... I ain't too hype. I don't like playing to begin with. And I ain't too hype about all the COVID going on. In terms of symbolism, Juan, is it fair to compare the following big historical gestures? Pinling volunteering as a porter at the Britannia Beach Hotel and Dr. Minnis volunteering to help in the vaccination effort. It will be so helpful if more vaccination sites were centrally located. One, that ship and the persons involved breached law in regards to all the agencies you mentioned. The Bahamas cannot be the dumping ground for garbage from any other nation. Does Juan give Levin and Aaron those 2 hours? Hey, if they want them, they can have them. Juan, did you find out about the plane crash with the two Bahamian pilots who got killed in Abaco? Yeah, there was a report today. Well, not today, but there was a report released over the weekend, I believe, into what happened, and they said they weren't familiar with the controls, and that led to their demise. I'll go through it in more detail tomorrow. It says, you just ruined my next 2 weeks, at least send Levin. Says, declaring what's on your vessel is like faxing or emailing info. No one physically boards the ship to double-check that paperwork is correct. That's true. It says, Juan, the gentleman from the port said it was not a dumping. Rather, the situation was a regular occurrence, so there are businesses that take care of that kind of refuse and environmentally destroy it. It's an actual business and service provided. The problem was that the Environmental Health Office was not contacted in this particular instance before the items were offloaded. Yeah, that may be, says Lester Cox. That's a good idea. Maybe Lester is interested in hosting. All ships have agents, and somewhere along the line, someone did not do their job. This says, good day, Juan. So the vessel a few years ago dumped their refuse in our water. The United States sued. The settlement was $40 million. We got nothing. So I guess the United States and the people that did the dumping shared the money. Sounds like a setup. No, I don't. Ain't no share no money. The court ordered them to pay, and pay they did. And then put a monitor on the ship. Well, the monitor was already on the ship. That's how they knew they did it. Says, BNT and the fake environmentalists on Grand Bahama are aware of Grand Bahama being a dump site for maritime. As a lawyer, environmental spokesman, and his sidekick knows that person, law firm, represents 95% of the industrial companies and support the companies on GB, fake outrage. What about the dozen violations each month? It says, I heard a caller say all vessels must declare their passengers and cargo before entry, but would that vessel list that particular cargo as infested material? Would? Good question. This says, and which party? Hey, Juan, what would happen if nobody won the election? What effect would that have on the government and its people? What? You have to. What are you saying? If the winner of the election is unclear, what happens? That is a very good question. I don't know. I don't know what happens. Do we have a mechanism to deal with that? How does that work? If there's no Minister of Finance, how does that work? Like, what happens? Who takes control? The Prime Minister? No one knows who won the election. So there's no, if we around Claire, the winner of the election, so we don't know what to do. Go back again, do it over. Why don't you get that deal at the Cove again? I want that deal too. No, I didn't get the Cove deal. Says the calls are correct. The Bahamas continues to be used and disrespected by the international community. And to date, very little, if any, consequence comes of it. In a way, I can't blame them because of our incompetence in so many things that we allow and how we operate. It says the GG has the House choose a leader. But what if there's no clear majority? The House has to come to some compromise as to become prime minister? That's an interesting question. That's an interesting constitutional question we should explore one day. It says, one, Sharika Jackson didn't make it to the 400-meter semifinal. She slowed down at the finish line, and she lost her placing. Oh, okay. This says, in today's Tribune, Elnett Marine's chief executive, Albert Hepburn, said Freeport's business is routinely taking offloading of goods rejected by the U.S. His company has been looped into the investigation. He also said no customs officer came to the ship, and that's commonplace. Well, it's, you're saying it's 39 seats and it has to be a majority, but what if you have independent candidates? You see what I'm saying? Says, hi, Juan, I saw that vibe too from the 100 meters woman sweep, but then Jamaican's rolling. Yep. Says, I don't think the issue is that Sean is running two races. It's a very competitive field out there, and these young runners are firepowers. Sean A took a gamble on the 200 and it didn't pay off. So what? That's life. We do it every day. She did her best and that's good enough for me and should be for us all. We don't have to make excuses for her, but let's just accept it and continue to support her and all of our athletes, whether or not she has success in 400. Absolutely. We'll still support her. We still love her. It says Michael Johnson of the USA won gold and set Olympic records in the 200 and 400 meters in 1996. It can be done. Juan Millerribos, not sure if she will still run the 400, but the 400 border could have been an easier race with the two of the top challengers, the Namibians not being able to participate. She should have just concentrated on the 400 because the 200 would have been much more challenging with both Namibians and Thompson in the 200. You see an 18-year-old girl, 18-year-old lady from Namibia today? She was hot on Thompson's heels, man. She beat, what's her name? Shelly-Ann. Yeah, she's 18. First Olympics. Says she's rolling, Papa. Someone's saying that's a man. Oh, is that the one who had the testosterone? She ain't no man. Don't do that to her. She just got a lot of testosterone going on. Says, I see. Well, Whitey.
I see.
That's her. Okay. She is rolling. Oh, we got to go. Okay. Can I get the rest of your text messages? That's going to do it for today. We'll be back tomorrow. It says beetles can fly over the ocean. They got it like that. All right. Yeah, I can't answer all these. These are too many. Okay. That's it. We got to go. You guys take care out there. Have a great day. Bahamas, we'll talk more tomorrow.